when the fight got announced, you know, I spoke to Bob, I rang Bob, and we had a chat, and I said, look, Bob, it's not going to be, we're not going to have it one of them fights where everyone's giving, having a go at each other and doing this and doing that, you know, because I've got loads of respect for Bob.
But it is now time to put all them connections, bonds and emotions to one side. And when they enter the square ring on December the 3rd at the Robin Park Centre in Wigan, the competitiveness that runs through each participant in this meeting, boxer and trainer, will come to the fore, and this highly anticipated Lancashire derby fight will for a short time split them into rivals, each determined and professional enough to put their friendships aside in a name of pugilism.
Whatever happens in boxing, you've got to be ahead of your opponent, haven't you? You've got to make sure everything's right.
Respect for any fighter who gets in the ring with me, you know, and I respect him. You know, I've sparred with him a few times, a few years back now. I can say that I'm an improved fighter since then. But like I say, we've trained for this fight like we train for any other fight. I'm a champion. I want to stay champion. You know, I've trained like a champion, and you know, I'm going to stay champion. So yeah. But like I say, he's a good fighter, and you know, me and my trainer have not underestimated him, and I just can't wait to get in there now on December the 3rd.
I mean, I've been dreaming about this since I was 9 years old, since I started boxing. I had my first amateur fight when I was 11, so for me this is a dream come true, even fighting for the British title, but I'm going to grab it with both hands and win the British title. I've waited too long for it. I mean, I was supposed to fight for it after the Maxwell fight, but it just wasn't to be. But I knew I'd get that second chance, and there's no way I'm going to give that up.
Right from the very first time he trained, I knew it was something different. You know, that jab is unbelievable. You know, it's second to none, is it? You know, that jab and his movement and his footwork and stuff like that. And even then I knew that, you know, this kid had something.
Feel like they can overcome the obvious attributes that Prince Arron has got?
Definitely. I mean, I'm known as a technical boxer. That's what I do. So sometimes I think too much about what I'm doing in the ring, but on that night, I'm going to have to think, and I'm going to have to think about getting underneath him and taking it to him. It's not something I'm used to doing, but it's something that, I'm going to do. I've been boxing since the age of nine. I've boxed as an amateur all over the world against different styles, different people from different countries. They've all got different styles, so it's something that's not new for me. I mean, I've done it as an amateur, so it's not new. It's not new to me in that sense. So it's something that'll all come flooding back to me. I've got the experience. I've got the technical ability. I just need to do it on the night tactically. I need to get my tactics right. Get my tactics right. I know I'll win the fight. I mean, I'll be the first British title. I'll be the first person to win the British title since Brian London from Blackpool. So. For me, being from Blackpool, it's a massive achievement, and it would mean the world to me. I mean, it'd be the proudest moment of my boxing career. I mean, winning the English title was good enough, but winning the British title was just the happiest thing in my life. When I turned pro, I came to Manchester and I tried a few gyms. I mean, I remember going to Bob Shannon's gym. I spoke to Anthony Farnell, but when I spoke to Bobby, we just clicked.
You don't want everything. No, I open your book. Cook, clean, train, all the way.
You don't want the arsehole, does it, mate? You don't do everything.
Mate, I'm not supposed to do that, I'm on.
Yeah?
I'll hold you up. Only ask him to clean the back of yourself, you can't do that sometimes. Oh, you're in the major 20 sheets.
I mean, he offered me a flat to live in as well. And we just clicked, and I knew we'd get on, and I knew he was for me. And I mean, I've not looked back ever since. I mean, we have our ups and downs, like I was telling you about before, but. Every trainer and boxer do, especially when they're living under the same roof. But we get on, he treats me like a son. And that's why sometimes we don't get on, but we get on brilliantly. I mean, living with him is such a laugh. And but he eating, I mean, he makes me eat the right foods. He makes sure I'm going for runs because I'm living with him. There's no getting out of training. So it's a good thing that I live with him.
Your working relationship when you are in the gym, what strengths does Bobby give you? What are his strengths as a coach?
I mean, every boxer he's got is a fit. He gets every boxer fit as they can be. He works them into the ground. He's brilliant at that. But he's also good at the technical side of things. I mean, he's learned me a lot on my defence for this fight. He's good at all aspects. I couldn't put my finger on one thing because he's good at everything.
Right, this is Bobby's house.
You and Prince Arron are friends, you know each other, spar together, you know each other well. You know, will you be able to put friendships aside and go in there and, you know, do take care of business?
Yeah, I mean, me and Prince Arron boxed in Gillingham together when he won the British title, I defended my English title, so, I mean, we had breakfast the next day. Together, knowing that we could probably fight each other next, but it's just boxing. I mean, boxers have a lot of respect for each other, and that's what it's about. But I'm sure both of us will put differences aside that night we fight on the 3rd December because we both want that British title. He wants to keep hold of it, and I want to obviously win it. So may the best man win.
He's 6'3", obviously very tall, rangy. You know, is he like anyone you've ever fought before?
Well, I'm over the moon. You said he's 6'3", because I thought he was 6'4". So, I'm used to. I'm tall for the weight. I'm 6 foot. I'm used to punching down, so I've got to change my tactics. I'm not used to punching up, so it's something that's a little bit alien-like to me. But it's something that I can definitely do. I've been working on it for the last ten weeks. So. On the night, I'll be ready for the fight, tactically and physically.
Prior to this fight, you was getting ready to defend your English title against Eric Ogjiang. Obviously, you've given your title up since then to concentrate on this fight. So, you know, did you have a split in training and you know, you've changed your tactics now for this fight?
I mean, I was in training for 12 weeks for the Ocheng fight, and then I found out 4 weeks before the Ocheng fight that I was fighting for the British title. Well, I got given the opportunity and I took it. I mean, I wanted to fight Ocheng and then fight for the British, but my promoters and Bobby, my trainer, said otherwise. He said it's too much of a risk. If you get a cut, knock a hand up. I mean, it's only 8 weeks after that fight, so it's not a risk that they wanted to take, but I'm just glad I've been given the opportunity.
You are from Blackpool, Aaron's from Manchester. You know, you're almost like an adopted Mancunian. You're training with Bobby Rimmer. You know, it is a Lancashire derby, but you know, it's almost like a Manchester derby as well, really.
It is. I mean, I sell a lot of tickets here myself, because people see me as a Manchester lad. When I go back to Blackpool, people say, "Oh, you're talking like a Manc." And but it's just, I've been here for 5 years, so I mean, this is like my second home, and I do class it. I love Manchester. It's where I'm based. It's where Bobby's from, and I mean, I live with Bobby when I'm here, so I love the place.
And you know, Manchester boxing, Northwest boxing is thriving at the moment. You know, is it great to be a part of that and to be involved in it at this, you know, at such a time like this?
Yeah, of course it is. I mean, we've got the Liverpool lads, the Smith brothers, they're doing well. We've got all the lads from Manchester. I mean, it's good to be a part of that, and fighting for the British title next will put me in the same league as them sort of people, which is brilliant for the Northwest.
And where we are at the moment, we are in Manchester, we are surrounded by the Pennines and Dove Stones. And I know
Dove Stones, it's my nightmare, that.
Tell us about Dove Stones and how you're training there.
We do Dove Stones every Saturday. I come last every time, by the way. but yeah, we do Dove Stones every Saturday. I run Monday, Wednesday, Friday, I run 6 miles. Tuesday, Thursday, I do my sprints with Steve Mailey at Carl Place, Terry Flanagan. And on a Saturday, we do Dove Stone, which is just over four miles up the Pennines, Mosley, is it? Yeah. And that's tough, it's grueling. And then we get the weekend off after that. That's our treat, have the weekend off.
About you working with Brian?
I was training Gomez at the time, and I didn't even have a gym. I was using a bloke called Tommy Wood's gym, because me and Scott Gledhill was building Ultimate Fitness. Me and Scott was partners building Ultimate Fitness in the first place, and I didn't really have a gym. So I was down at Arnie's with Mike Gomez, training Gomez, doing some sparring there. And Wally Dixon walked in with his kid, and he went, "This is Brian Rose." And I thought, I've heard of this kid, Brian Knowles. And I'd seen him a couple of times and thought he was, you know, but the kid he introduced me to, he looked like a pork sausage with a wig on. This overweight kid with long brown hair and blonde streaks in the front, you know what I mean? I thought, this was a bit strange, you know what I mean? Anyway, Wally said he's been training in Blackpool, but he's had one pro fight. And he's had a trapped thoracic nerve under his shoulder, so he's not been out of box. So we're looking for a new trainer for him. So I said, well, And I had a chat with him, with Brian, and he was very quiet, very kind of in on himself, you know what I mean? And I really took to him, you know what I mean? So I had a flat in Openshaw, you know, right near the Grove National Road, you know, right in the hood, innit, you know what I mean? So I said, well, I've got a flat there at the house, like, if Brian wants to move in, he wants to train with me, but I've not got a proper gym yet, but as he's got an injury, we can sort his injury out, because I'm good friends with Stuart Cosgrove, the physio, in Bolton there, and a good friend of Kerry Casey's. So I said, yeah, so we went and got him a bed off me mate, Jimmy Blackshaw, put the bed in the flat and moved him in the flat. He was only in there one night. Now you can imagine, can't, he's come from Blackpool, near the seaside, to Ashnall Road. It was like, so we had to get him from there, and he come and stayed at my house, and he's been with me ever since. You know, he moved in with me and Deb, and I was with Deb then, the wife, and and the kids. He moved in with us all, like, and he became part of the family, you know what I mean? And that was how it started, you know.
He's a tough boxer, but he's not tough enough for old Ashton Hall Road.
No, he's not. Listen, he wasn't quite out for Ashton Hall Road then, do you know what I mean? But, I remember one night when I was stayed at the... We went back to the flat and stayed at the flat. I remember one night I'd fell out with Deb when I split up with Deb, and I was staying in the flat with him, and we heard this commotion outside, and we're looking out the window, and it's just a normal Saturday night, about 3 or 4 kids all bashing each other on the head with sticks and all that. He was absolutely mortified, Brian, you know what I mean? He couldn't believe it, that he's actually seen someone bashing somebody on the head with a stick, you know what I mean? So, yeah, it was a rude awakening for him.